department, and it's with me and Professor John Boron. He's director of Cyber Physical Networking Laboratory, and we are working on this project, taking soil to the cloud. Here is the overview of my talk. I will first introduce the wireless sensor networks and the soil as a communication medium in wireless underground sensor networks, and then pulse response model of the underground channel, experimental methodology and test beds that we have developed to model this response. And then I will discuss some important statistics before concluding this talk. Wireless underground sensor networks are the networks in which nodes are buried underground, and these underground nodes can not only communicate with other underground nodes but also with other above ground nodes. And these networks have application in many areas like precision agriculture, landslide monitoring, pipeline monitoring and water fencing, golf clubs. So all these areas, in all these areas, wireless underground sensor networks are being used. Here is the architecture of the taking soil to the cloud. Here you see the bottom nodes over there. These are the underground nodes, and these can communicate with the infrastructure nodes. The infrastructure nodes are the nodes which are mounted on the above ground infrastructures, like the centrifuge in this case. And the above ground nodes collect information from the underground node and then relay it to the cloud. Like, so this architecture is basically a generalized architecture which can not only collect the data through the communication part, but can also help in the real-time decision making as well. If you have been attending today's presentation, you would notice that this could serve everyone's need. For example, this link from the from this computer to the cloud, this can go to the Professor Francisco's big data. So instead of accessing the data from 10,000 wells, the wells itself are emitting the data and giving it to the cloud for the big data analysis. Similarly, William had a problem of the dry run for his cosmic ray probe. If he can bring those probes either underground or above ground, then these nodes can communicate that data. And similarly, Professor Bokan and Professor Walia's drought distance analysis, these soil moisture sensors can also serve that need. So it's a hybrid generalized architecture which have the onboard sensing capabilities, communication through the soil, and then relate that data for the real-time decision making for any particular customized shape. Here is one of the application that using nodes are buried in the ground, and then the above ground node is in the center pivot, and once the center pivot collects the data from the underground nodes and can make real-time decisions about irrigation, like variable rate irrigation. There are actually three types of channels that are involved in the wireless underground channel. One is U2U, that's the communication channel between two underground nodes, and then one is from above ground node to underground node, and then the reverse channel from the underground node to the above ground node. Why this channel modeling is important? There are very few channel models actually that for the underground communication. Over the air channels cannot be applied due to properties of soil that I will discuss in a moment. But therefore customized channels are required. So to understand that communication, we need to do channel modeling and tailored solution that particularly fits in that need. So therefore, this channel modeling can give us insight into the physical characteristics of underground communications. Before going into underground communications, let's see how soil affects this underground communication. There are four factors: soil texture and the bulk density, soil moisture variation, distance and depth, and the frequency on which these nodes are operating. First, here is the soil texture triangle. So the soils are divided into 12 classes based on the percentage of the clay, sand, and silt. So out of these, we have selected three representative soils from these three corners: sand, silt, loam, and silty clay loam to be used in our test beds. We have an array of test beds, both indoor, field, outdoor test beds, through which we have been doing these experiments and modeling the underground channel. Second, the soil moisture also affects the underground communication. In the underground communication, there is a diffuminate animation that comes from the real part of the permittivity of the soil, and then there is an additional attenuation that is not there in the over-tier cases. That is water absorption attenuation. And then again, the permittivity varies over time. So here is a graph that shows the change in the volumetric water content over a period of 3 months in a field setting. So the soil moisture variation also needs to be taken into account to model the other one challenge. Third, this is a soil profile that we have been talking through this morning about that where the soil sensor should go. The soil profile is basically divided into horizons. Top O and A horizon are the layers at which most of the biological activity is going on, and these are the horizons which are responsible for the root growth as well. So that most of the sensors will go there because we need to know the soil moisture data up to 40-50 centimeter to make real-time decisions about the irrigation. So as the sensors go deep, the communication is generated more. So these distance and depth should also be accounted for. And the frequency, lower frequencies suffer lower attenuation. Once you use the higher frequency to communicate in the underground scenario, the loss is higher. This is a typical setup in a South Center Agriculture Laboratory in the Clay Center, where we have these USRPs. These are software-defined radios. So we conduct experiments by using these radios to assess the at different frequencies to assess the impact of frequency on the underground. And similarly, channel capacity is also a function of the channel frequency. Here is an overview of electromagnetic wave propagation in the underground scenario. Here you see air soil. This line shows the soil air interface. There are three type of waves that are responsible for the communication in the underground scenario. One is the direct wave. That is transmitted from the transmitter to the receiver, and then there is a reflected wave that is reflected from the soil air interfaces to reach at the receiver, and then there is a third, another important wave that travels towards the soil air interface, then travels along the interface and reaches at the receiver. It basically continuously diffuses inward and reach at the receiver. So. You can see that this is a model that we have developed to capture all these effects. This is a contribution of this work that was voted by this WFI grant. We have developed this model that can take into account the number of multipaths in all these three components, channel gains, and the delays associated with each of these components. So this model gives us insight into the underground communication. And then we calculate the speed of the wave in soil. That is quite different from speed of the wave in the air because of the complex permittivity of the soil. So once the waves travel in the underground scenario, these are much slower, like 5 times slower as compared to over the air communications. We have developed this model through empirical measurements. The measurements that we have done in a couple of test beds. First, I will explain the indoor test bed that we have developed for this. It's a wooden box with these dimensions in a greenhouse setting, and it contains 90 cubic feet of soil. The gravel is placed for easy infiltration of water, and you can see on that in the red circle there are pipes basically that helps the infiltration. And then soil is placed after every 30 centimeter and packed using a tamper tool to achieve the bulk density as close to the real field to achieve that bulk density. And then it's again saturated to let it set, and then further soil is placed on. The purpose of the development of this test bed is to attain a flexible level of soil moisture level, because in the field we cannot get the soil moisture level does not stay the same for a longer period of time, and so basically with this infiltration we can saturate it first, we can start doing experiments, and then we let it dry, and with each soil moisture level we do more experiments. Once it's settled down, after the packing, we place these antennas. So there are three set of antennas that are used, dipole antennas, and there are sensors installed over there to monitor the soil moisture level, and these sensors are connected to this watermark monitor, which can log the data for months. The minimum frequency is 15 minutes, so it can log 15 minutes to a month of data. And then you see there are some overhead drying lights over there to achieve the faster drying process. This shows the change in the soil moisture in the indoor test bed. That's a silt loam test bed. So there are two types of forces that actually affect on the water inside the soil. These are weighted forces, reduction and capillarity. So measure of these forces give us the soil moisture, soil weighted potential. This shows the change in the soil moisture at four depths, 10, 20, and 30, 40 centimeter over a period of month. You can see that 10 centimeter changes faster as compared to the 40 centimeter. And these values are in CB. So CB, zero CB value mean the wet soil, and as the CB value, CB stands for centipar. As the CB value decreases, it's mean lower soil moisture. Here is the antenna layout and experiment setup. So we have used the vector network analyzers to take the channel transfer function measurements and impulse response measurements. So basically, we collect the time domain measurements, and then we process them to get these parameters. Here is another test bed in outside the greenhouse to verify and validate those measurements taken in the indoor test bed, and also take the angle measurements. Here is a dipole mounted on a pole. So basically, we vary the angle from the underground node to do experiment to see that how the centripetal moves, how it affects that. This is a diagram of the vector network analyzer. We take channel transfer function measurements and we do an inverse Fourier transform to get the time domain data, and then that's post processed to get the RMS place effect, coherence bandwidth, and attenuation statistics that are used then in the channel modeling. Here you see that the three components, the dotted line shows the major component, and these green, blue, and red lines, these shows the lines from the, that we have achieved from the model. So it's a very good match with the major data. There are some differences. As you can see that with the red component, it's 7.5%. With the lateral wave, it's 7.3%. So these differences in measurement and model values can be attributed to the delays inside the vector network analyzer. This is for the silt loam soil. So as I stated that we have used three soils, and for all three soils, silt loam, silty clay loam, and the sandy soil, these has the very good agreement between the measurement and the model value. Sandy soil has a lower deviation because of the low water holding capability. Sandy soil have larger pore size, so which helps in lower retention of the water. So that's why it has a higher infiltration and low retention. These are some of the statistics about the coherence bandwidth. Coherence bandwidth actually tells us that for the underground communication, what is the maximum bandwidth that you can use? Because after that, if you use a higher bandwidth than that, the frequencies will not be correlated. So that will result into the higher loss. So in the outdoor test bed, in the city loam tile, maximum is 650 kilohertz. This shows the impact of the soil moisture variation. You can see that this is a power delay profile. This graph shows that attenuation will change in soil moisture. With the high soil moisture, the red line, you can see that the attenuation is high. With the soil, as the soil moisture is decreased because of the reduced effect of the osmotic and metric forces, attenuation has decreased. This shows it for two values, 0 CB and 50 CB. So the conclusion over here is that as the soil moisture decreases, attenuation decreases as well. RMS place effect is another metric that can be used to look into the wireless channel. So this shows the variation with the soil moisture. With the near saturation level, it decreases first, and then it has increased with the decrease in the soil moisture. This graph shows the attenuation in the soil for the underground to underground node in silty clay loam soil. Here you can see that attenuation has increased with the distance. For the 12 meter, it has the highest attenuation, about 90 dB loss as compared to what was sent. So with this change in soil moisture, the coherence bandwidth, and this attenuation, this actually requires the cognitive operation. So that once the soil moisture changes, you change the frequency. Based on the depth and distance, you adjust your parameters, like you can decrease your data rate and you can adjust other communication parameters. Here are some of the other statistics that are related to the communication for all these three soils, like mean access delay, RMS delay, spread, and the path loss. In the sandy soil, you can see that the path loss is lower, the attenuation is lower, but on the other hand, delay spread has increased. So, but on the city clay loam and silt loam soil, we have the higher attenuation because of the higher water holding capability of these soils. So the system must be tailored, communication system must be tailored for according to the soil in which these are deployed. And here are some of those important findings which any communication designer who is working in this area can use to design a system. So with this, I have come to the conclusion of my talk. So basically we have characterized the underground-to-underground communication system, underground-to-underground communication channel, which can be used to transfer information not only from underground node but to above ground node and then subsequently to the cloud.